An infrastructure cybersecurity bill passes the Senate, Nvidia confirms data was stolen in a hack, and Ukraine versus Russia, part two. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for March 8th, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. I have got some updates on the cyber war that is going on this week, so on to the first news story. Last Tuesday, the US Senate passed with unanimous consent a new piece of legislation aimed at increasing cybersecurity for critical infrastructure, along with making coordination between government agencies and civilian industry better for the United States. Now, this bill is called the Strengthening American Cybersecurity Act of 2022, but it actually combines three other bills into one big 200-page one. Now, those three bills are the Cyber Incident Reporting Act, aka CIRA, the Federal Information Security Management Act, aka FISMA, and the Federal Secure Cloud Improvement and Jobs Act, aka FSCIJA. To give you a quick overview of what we can expect, this new bill is meant to make it a legal requirement for entities that get hit with a cyber attack or experience some kind of incident to report that within 72 hours to the U.S. Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Agency, or CISA. Ransomware payments must be reported within 24 hours of the payment taking place. Those entities are also required to preserve data and keep the government updated with any relevant information pertaining to the incident. It also includes a five-year stipulation called the Federal Risk and Authorization Management Program, or FedRAMP, which gives agencies 5 years to upgrade to secure cloud-based technologies that will improve operations and efficiency. This bill is sponsored by Michigan Democratic Senator Gary Peters, and it was brought to the Senate by Peters as well as Senator Rob Portman. The soon-to-be bill will also have to get through the House before it's made into law when President Biden signs it. But since this is a bipartisan agreement across political lines, we can expect the same swift passage to happen in the House. Given the rising tide of cyber warfare that we have seen in just the last few weeks, this swift passage comes as no surprise. To follow up on last week's story regarding Nvidia, they have officially confirmed that data was stolen in that cyber attack they experienced back in February. On the 23rd, they did publicly state that they had detected a cybersecurity incident, but they would not confirm if data was stolen. Now, while Nvidia was silent on the matter, a hacker group called Lapsus claimed that they were the attackers, and they started to leak data publicly, while telling Nvidia their demands, including a request that Nvidia remove LHR limitations for their 30 series GPUs. They threatened to leak proprietary information about Nvidia's tools and products, along with employee credentials. Now, Lapsus did leak about 20 gigs worth of data, claiming it had over 1 terabyte total that they still had not leaked. So now we have confirmation, but more has happened since then. Nvidia has confirmed that about 71,000 employees' credentials were stolen. That includes email addresses and NTLM password hashes, many of which apparently have already been cracked and are being spread. This database has also already been added to the Have I Been Pwned website as well. As of March 3rd, Nvidia's source code for their DLSS technology has also been leaked online. Now, this is the deep learning super sampling rendering tech that increases graphics performance. Lapsus did not end there. They also upgraded their demands. Now they want Nvidia to also make their GPU drivers open source. And if Nvidia does not do so, Lapsus has threatened to leak all their files for their silicon chipset, aka trade secrets from Nvidia. Nvidia has declined to comment on whether or not they would respond to these demands as of time of recording. Lapsus also leaked two code signing certificates, both of which are digital signatures for executables and drivers that tell the operating system and the user that a file's owner is legit and verified. This is also used to tell if a file has been tampered with before you actually go and install it. The ones that Lapsus leaked are expired, but Windows still allows for them to be used for simple signing of drivers, which means that they will still load on the OS, and they look like they come from Nvidia. As such, security researchers started discovering that these stolen certificates are being used to sign malware, rats, backdoors, tools like Cobalt Strike, beacons, and Mimikatz as well. Windows will likely need to revoke those stolen certificates, but this may block legitimate drivers from being installed, so this is still an open problem. As of time of recording again, we have not seen any additional leaks, but I highly doubt that Lapsus is done. I will keep y'all updated whenever we see news surface on this story. Before I get started on story number three, I wanted to say a big shout out to my Hush Puppy Perk level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. And also a huge thank you to Nick, Meets PC Repair Shop, Nahuel, Nathan, Crypto Hacker, and Donald for joining on patreon.com/threatwire. And shout out to everyone who supports the show. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story about the ongoing cyber war. Now, stories like this one take a very long time to research and work on. It is very time intensive, so if you appreciate this content, please do consider supporting the show. We are not going to see an end to this cyber warfare happening anytime soon, so as long as there is new information to share, I'm planning to keep you updated on the conflict. There is a lot happening, so I will be giving you a summary to catch you up with any important information. And while a lot of folks still think this is just about Russia and Ukraine, it actually affects all of us, so pay attention because cyber warfare has no borders. First up, we recently learned from ESET that a new data wiper is being deployed against Ukrainian orgs and government. This is called Isaac Wiper, and it is being distributed along with a new worm called Hermetic Wizard, which is also being used to distribute a wiper called Hermetic Wiper. Now, they have not been attributed to a specific threat actor at time of publication, and they are not similar to other malware samples at the moment. It's also unknown if Isaac Wiper and Hermetic Wiper are linked in any way. Hermetic Wiper was just discovered on February 23rd, just hours before Russia started invading Ukraine. Isaac Wiper started showing up on Ukrainian networks on February 24th. Right now, it appears both of those are just targeting Ukrainian networks, but they could potentially hit networks outside Ukraine as well. Ransomware called Hermetic Ransom was also deployed with this as a decoy in the Wiper attacks. As such, Avast worked to get a decryptor out ASAP for the Hermetic Ransom ransomware decoy after CrowdStrike discovered an implementation error which made the ransomware encryption breakable. Microsoft is tracking Hermetic Wiper via the name Foxblade, and they stated that its intention is to disrupt, degrade, and destroy targeted resources. Along with this malware, spear phishing campaigns are also targeting Ukrainian supporters. Ukrainian armed service members' email accounts are being targeted and compromised to send spear phishing emails to European government personnel who are aiding Ukrainian refugees. The emails have a malicious macro attachment which downloads malware called Sunseed, which can deliver a second stage payload to an infected device. Some are linking this to Ghostwriter, which is the hacking group from Belarus. The phishing emails were first seen on February 24th, and they are being called Asylum Ambuscade. Now, currently, Ukraine is experiencing power outages and internet outages across several cities due to the invasion. NetBlocks posted data about internet outages in Ukraine due to the Russian military offenses, like the physical destruction of actual infrastructure. Websites run on WordPress are also being hit with attacks that are targeting vulnerabilities, according to WordFence. The company reported seeing a 10-time spike in attacks on websites that they protect, such as Ukrainian universities, government, and military and law enforcement. WordFence responded by deploying threat intelligence tools on all Ukrainian websites, even if a subscription for that tier of their product is not active. They also blocked the IP addresses involved in these attacks. Other companies are also stepping up on supporting Ukraine. Microsoft is stopping all sales of new services and products to Russia in compliance with sanctions. Intel and AMD have also stopped sales to Russia. Namecheap, a domain registrar here in the US, is now offering free domains and hosting to sites protesting Russia and Belarus, while also banning registrations from Russia. Meanwhile, Google and their employees are together donating $15 million to relief efforts for Ukraine. They are giving free advertising to aid and refugee support organizations. Some Google Maps have been disabled in the country of Ukraine to protect local communities. They've blocked YouTube channels that are connected to RT or Sputnik across Europe, and monetization of state-funded Russian channels has also been disabled. Now, no surprise, Russian cybersecurity firm Kaspersky stated that they weren't in a position to comment or speculate on geopolitical developments outside of its area of expertise. Right. But Russia is being hit with attacks too. The Conti ransomware group got hit with additional leaks of their own data, such as source code for the ransomware and even more internal conversations than what I reported on last week. This leak also contained a decryptor tool, but this won't work with the latest version of the ransomware, so FYI. Hacktivists are also focusing on the skies by targeting the Russian Space Research Institute website and defacing it, and leaking files purportedly from the Russian Space Agency, which is called Roscosmos. Now, none of this necessarily means that a satellite was taken over, but the head of Roscosmos took this opportunity to let everyone know that hacking satellite infrastructure is a crime and is an act of war. I mean, so is invading a neighboring country, but who's counting, right? I don't know, that sounds a little bit hypocritical. Of course, hacktivism comes with a word of caution. Attacks could disrupt intelligence operations set up by Ukrainian military agencies or government partners, and it could lead to accidental escalations or distract operatives from their current initiatives. If a network is defaced or taken down, an agency could lose access to important reconnaissance if they were also accessing the same network. Now, while we are seeing activism by Ukrainian supporters and Russian sites blocked or orgs sanctioned, we are also seeing the latter. Russia is blocking social media sites like Facebook and Twitter. News outlets such as the BBC are also being blocked. Russia has also shared the IP addresses used in DDoS attacks against Russian organizations, totaling about 17,000 different IP addresses. This list includes IPs for the FBI and the CIA, along with a bunch of other organizations as well. Even though Ukraine is not a member of NATO, they were just accepted as a contributing participant to NATO's CCDCOE, which is the Cooperative Cyber Defense Center of Excellence. This center is used to share training, resources, research, and more with member nations, so this could give Ukraine access to additional resources that they have not had yet. Ukraine's government requested that ICANN shut down Russia's DNS root servers and domains last week, but many denounced this request, as it would affect regular folks in Russia by making network connectivity spotty, and it could make civilians vulnerable to cyber attacks. It could splinter the World Wide Web, cutting off Russian civilians from the rest of our global internet. ICANN replied to Ukraine's letter by denying the request, though also saying they stand ready to continue to support Ukraine. The internet exists without borders, and we are currently seeing that in action now with a cyber war. Do you want to see more tech videos from me? Make sure to check out my YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/ShannonMorse for everything from tech reviews to security tutorials. And with that, do not forget to like and subscribe to Hack5. I'm Shannon Morse. Stay safe, and I will see you on the internet.